Meine sehr geehrten Damen und Herren, sehr geehrte Frau Professor Stone, sehr geehrter Herr Professor Mondal, ich freue mich sehr, Sie heute Abend in der Blumenthal-Akademie des Jüdischen Museums Berlin begrüßen zu dürfen. Mein Name ist Hafsa Al-Buhamuchi und ich bin wissenschaftliche Mitarbeiterin des Jüdisch-Islamischen Forums Berlin. Der heutige Abend ist der vierte Abend der dritten Staffel unserer Ringvorlesung, die sich in diesem Jahr den jüdischen und islamischen Perspektiven auf Menschenrechte widmet. Gefördert wird diese Reihe durch die Allianz Kulturstiftung, der ich hier meinen sehr herzlichen Dank aussprechen möchte. In den bisherigen Veranstaltungen unserer Reihe haben wir nach dem Geltungsanspruch und der Universalität der Menschenrechte gefragt und ebenso auch nach ihren religiösen Begründungen. Schließlich haben wir über den jüdischen und muslimischen Diskurs zur Umsetzung der Menschenrechte diskutiert und heute widmen wir uns dem Thema Meinungsfreiheit. Dabei wollen wir fragen, inwieweit und wo Judentum und Islam bereit sind, das Recht auf Meinungsfreiheit zu gewähren. Ich freue mich sehr, dass wir auch für den heutigen Abend wieder Frau Dr. Nahed Samour als Moderatorin gewinnen konnten. Frau Samour ist keine Unbekannte in unserer Akademie. Sie ist Rechts- und Islamwissenschaftlerin und studierte in Bonn, Berlin, Ramallah, Damaskus, London und Harvard sowie am Max-Planck-Institut für europäische Rechtsgeschichte in Frankfurt. Seit 2015 ist sie Research Associate an der Harvard Law School. Derzeit forscht sie im Rahmen ihrer Habilitation über das Religionsverfassungsrecht. Bevor ich Nahed Samour das Wort übergebe, möchte ich Sie darauf hinweisen, dass die heutige Veranstaltung auf Englisch stattfindet und Sie sich hier an der Seite bei Bedarf Kopfhörer für die Übersetzung nehmen können. Nun wünsche ich uns allen einen anregenden Abend.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to yet another event in the series on Jewish and Islamic perspectives on human rights. I'm delighted to be moderating tonight's talk on critique in Judaism and Islam, inviting all of us to get a sense for the richness of a tradition of critique in both Jewish and Islamic learning that comes from understanding the open-ended nature of divine texts. Jewish and Islamic scholarly texts have beautifully documented the back and forth of arguments within religious communities as well as between religious communities. There is, or maybe there was, a deep understanding that it is only through critique that we can construct our knowledge around religion, around what God has possibly deemed to be correct for the believing. I'm not trying to say that critique as practiced in the past was one that did not involve risk, shunning, or forms of exclusion. And surely, critique was the realm of not everyone, but more often than not, it was the realm of the male, the elite, the powerful, excluding so many from voicing their concerns and their critiques. Yet it seems that at certain times and in certain places in history, there was more willingness to accept disagreement, to consent to large margins of heterodox expression and practice, and to defer judgment to God. Today, there is much more discomfort in discussing the paradoxes and dilemmas attending the supposed standoff between any orthodox religion and liberal democratic values. What are the frameworks at stake in understanding the conflicts between blasphemy and free speech, between religious taboos and freedoms of thought and expression, and between secular and religious worldviews? Is the language of the law an adequate mechanism for the adjudication of such conflicts? What other modes of discourse are available for the navigation of such differences in multicultural and multi-religious societies? Religious communities today are themselves struggling to define the role, the potential, as well as the limits of critique today. How to deal with critique that is navigating between hate speech, defamation, and legitimate criticism? And how do religious communities, Jewish and Muslim, deal with critics that come from their own midst? Surely critique, its potentials, and its harms are always also a reflection of power dynamics, who critiques, in which position of power, with which kinds of effects. Now I'm delighted that tonight's guests are no strangers to any of these dilemmas and have been thinking hard over the last years to expose potentials and limits of the discourse of critique and religion. Both speakers will talk to us from the inside of their religious traditions, as well as with the experience of intense dedication to the role of religion in a secular world. The first to guide us through this web of questions is Professor Suzanne Stone. And I'm honored to have her coming here to Berlin to speak to us about her very field of expertise. Professor Suzanne Stone is University Professor of Jewish Law and Contemporary Civilization. She's Professor of Law and Director of the Center for Jewish Law and Contemporary Civilization at the Benjamin N. Cardozo School of Law, Yeshiva University, New York. She has held the Gross Visiting Chair in Talmudic Civil Law at both the Harvard and University of Pennsylvania Law Schools. She's a graduate of Princeton University and Columbia University Law School, and was a Danforth Fellow in 1974 in Jewish History and Classical Religions at Yale University. So you see this dense experience of dealing with law and religion and not trying to dissect between the two. Before joining the Cardozo faculty, Stone clerked for Judge John Minor Wisdom of the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals and then practiced litigation at Paul Weiss, Rifkind, Wharton, and Garrison. In addition to teaching courses in Jewish law and political thought and Jewish law and American legal theory, she currently teaches federal courts in law, religion, and the state. Professor Stone writes and lectures on the intersection of Jewish thought, legal theory, and the humanities, and her publications include In Pursuit of the Countertext, The Turn to the Jewish Legal Model in Contemporary American Legal Theory, Harvard Law Review, and The Jewish Conception of Civil Society, Princeton University Press, and as well as Feminism and the Rabbinic Conception of Justice, Indiana University. If you, and her work has this and many other contributions have been translated into German, French, Italian, Hebrew, and Arabic. And if you master any of these languages, you're highly recommended to get hold of any of these contributions. But now, please welcome Professor Stone with me. The floor is yours.
I'm afraid the introduction is longer than my speech. So this is my second visit to Berlin, and I'm extremely grateful for the organizers of this series for inviting me. Berlin is the birthplace of my father, so it is very important for me to reconnect with it, and so I particularly treasure the invitation for that reason. The first time I was in Berlin a few years ago, I was at the Humboldt Law School, and it was actually during the Charlie Hebdo incident. And I remember it extremely well because there I was at the law school, and the very first conversation that I had was, should we reinstitute blasphemy laws? That was the conversation. Now, I was fresh off the American farm during the Obama era, a very different time. And my reaction was utter puzzlement at the time. Americans love their free speech, right? Liberty and the value of expression is extremely strong in the United States. And at the same time, I carried with me a Jewish sensibility. And that Jewish sensibility is both of enjoying critique, cultivating critique, but also enduring critique. And today is a day to say, and surviving it. So I actually was quite disconcerted, but that came also from not really looking at the matter seriously enough. And so I'm actually very happy to have this occasion in which to think again, right, and think through with you. So tonight's event has been organized around the conflict between free expression and religious sensibilities. That is, it's a conflict between religion and liberalism and secularism. So that poses a problem right from the outset that I just want to address so that we can keep it in view. And that is Judaism a religion? Right? This is one of those trick questions that is actually extremely difficult to answer. And it's not only a question of do we externally understand ourselves to be a religion? Surely we do, but also a nationality, a people. But it's actually a conversation within the religious tradition. That is both aspects, Judaism as peoplehood, as a nation, and Judaism as a devotional scheme that is framed around law, right? Both of those are part and parcel of what helps to shape the halakha, the Jewish, right, what we call the Jewish religious law. So, for example, right, if we speak about conversion, there are two ways to understand it, and the Talmud itself understands it in two ways, one of which is joining a people, and the other of which is accepting, right, the Jewish parallel to what might be called dogma, which is not dogma, but the commandments, right? A certain path and way of doing things. So we always have to keep, in thinking about this particular issue, we'll have to keep that distinction in mind. The second aspect that's peculiar to Judaism, tonight at least in our discussion, that also has to be borne in mind, of course, is that it starts its experience primarily as a minority, which has now become a majority, right, in one state. And finally, right, it's in conversation with Western values, but it also gave rise to Western values, right? So Judaism, perhaps to some extent, a little differently from Islam, which we will talk about later, right, is not poised in precisely the same place. So here's what I'd like to do tonight. What I'd like to do, the order of my talk is as follows. The first thing I want to do is just give you some kind of sense of the internal viewpoint of Judaism on matters of free speech, blasphemy, and the domain of legitimate criticism. And then the second thing I'd like to do is take a little bit of a closer look at the dynamic of criticism that Judaism experienced from without, right, rather than from within. And the kind of counter-reactions it elicited. And then we'll end with some thoughts of where do we go today, which may be my shortest section, despite the fact that I'm a law professor, right? I'm far more interested in the kind of theoretical dynamics than I am about practical proposals, as you'll shortly see. So the internal viewpoint. I think it is fair to say that there is that Judaism is a culture of criticism and disagreement. And we can begin with the prophets, right? That is, it is not a rabbinic development. It is enhanced by the rabbis, but it is very much the role of the prophets in the Hebrew Bible to criticize. That is their job, right? They are criticizers of the powers that be. And those powers that be certainly include the king, right, government, but it also includes religious leaders and the priests, right? So we begin with a heritage in which the idea of criticism is deeply, deeply important. The formative sources of Judaism, the Mishnah and the Talmud, right, just simply amplify this viewpoint. The Mishnah is a code of Jewish law. But it's a very peculiar code of Jewish law because it is filled with alternative opinions, right? You would not expect, if you opened up a code to tell you what the law is, that the code would say, okay, the rule is X, and then you read, but maybe it's Y. Or so-and-so said, no, it's not X, it's Y. Right? And yet the Mishnah, right, preserves all these multiple opinions, preserves dissents, and it stipulates itself that it's preserving those dissents not solely to register what was rejected, but also because those dissents might have to be rehabilitated at a later period of time. Right? Those dissents have some sort of normative weight. Okay. Now, how did the rabbis of the Talmud understand this culture of agreement? They called it arguments for the sake of heaven. Right? And I think one very crystallized example of it is the treatment of the most famous heretic in the Talmudic literature, Elisha ben Avuya. And Elisha ben Avuya, the story goes in the Talmud, was one of four rabbinic figures who ascended to the garden, the pardes, or sometimes called paradise, right? Had a mystical experience. The four emerged in different states. Elisha came out a heretic, right? And the rest of the story explains that his student, Rabbi Meir, right, he was labeled a heretic, though he was never excommunicated. He remained a heretic within the fold. And his student, Rabbi Meir, continued to study with him and continued to learn from him. Right? And so the saying goes in the Talmud, right, that, Rabbi Meir, right, he saw a half rotten fruit and he ate the good half and rejected the rest. Right? So there is, from the internal perspective, it's incredibly important that debate continue inside the community. Now, this doesn't mean that there aren't restraints on speech. But those restraints, and there are restraints on speech, but those restraints seem to be, on the whole, relatively narrow. Let me start with blasphemy. There is, indeed, right, the case of the blasphemer in Exodus in the Hebrew Bible, and he is taken, and he is taken out to be stoned. But how does the Talmud understand blasphemy? It understands blasphemy not as criticism of religion, but rather as the cursing of God. So the Talmud constricts blasphemy, right, which it, by the way, views as a universal obligation to refrain from, not solely incumbent on Jews, right, but it restricts blasphemy to the cursing of God using the tetragrammaton, which is the special name of God that essentially has disappeared from the tradition as to how to pronounce the ineffable name. Right? And without that, blasphemy doesn't occur. Right? So instead of allowing blasphemy, the concept of blasphemy to spread, to include denigrating religion, or denigrating religious doctrine, or denigrating believers, instead, blasphemy is narrowed and virtually read out of existence. And yet, it remains on the books as one of seven universal precepts that Judaism holds apply to everybody. Now, this is something that deserves an amount of pause. Judaism, as you know, understands itself to be a particularistic religion. That is, the commandments, right, understood to be given at Sinai to the Israelite people, the Torah, both written and oral, right, are obligations that are incumbent on Jews. Right? The rest of the world is not obligated to follow those laws. It is not a universal religion. But that doesn't mean it doesn't have a universal doctrine. It does. And its universal doctrine is something that's known as the Noahide Code. It's named after, right, Noah as a figure for humanity, Noah who survived the flood in the book of Genesis. And Noah is taken to be a figure for humanity. And the Noahide commandments try to capture, right, what are those universals that all humans are obligated to fulfill? And if so, right, they may merit salvation. Right? They are being just. So they're quite basic. Don't murder. Don't steal. Sexual immorality, don't do it. Don't eat a limb taken from a live animal. No idolatry. Only one has a positive slant, and that is institute courts. Create a legal system. Right? And then blasphemy. Now, if we understand, if we put together why blasphemy is in this list, and what then is the gist of blasphemy, and what this universal order is about, we can begin to understand what actually is animating the Jewish approach to questions of religious critique. So the gist of actually the parallels to blasphemy, or at least cognates that the Talmudic rabbis associate with blasphemy, is cursing one's parents, right? To curse God and cursing one's parents seems to be within a familiar, or at least it's within a category that has similarities to it. Now, what's that about? It's about a failure to understand. It's not about, certainly the way Maimonides presents it, it's not about our love of our parents alone or our human relationships. It's actually part of how we learn authority structures. This is how we learn authority structures. And indeed, right, respecting one's parents, according to Maimonides, is a norm precisely because it inculcates and shapes the ability to respect God, the ultimate authority. So if we understand that, then we understand also that there's something about blasphemy that also is about rejecting authority. And if we look at it as part and parcel of a complete network of what's considered to be the fundamental principles that all societies need to adhere to, we can see that what they're really all aimed at is the ability to have a decent social order. Right? They are social order principles. Right? A minimally just society is a society that refrains from bloodshed, from theft. It institutes courts of law. It doesn't engage in the moral corruption that idolatry was always biblically associated with, right? And it frames blasphemy as, and we'll hear about this more, I believe, also from Moral, right? It frames blasphemy in the context of keeping a community socially cohesive and well-ordered. Right? Now, if we also look at the restraints on the speech of insiders, right? The policing of the borders of insiders within Judaism, they too exhibit the same structure. They're not about debates about doctrine or about beliefs, right? Or about religious niceties. All of that is completely up for grabs. Debate and criticize as much as you want. What they are about, however, is policing some sense of social cohesiveness, right? Of the ability to live together, right, in a well-ordered society. So without having really a crime of blasphemy on the books, right, and having this large culture of debate, there must have been some limits. And what were those limits? Well, the limits were primarily reflected through a device called banning, the cherem, right? Banning or excommunication. Excommunication, which has its origins in the Talmudic period, though exactly what it meant then is a little bit shrouded in mystery, were the community's way to police its borders, to stop things that seemed to be, right, actually breaking up the community and its ability to function in some kind of cohesive whole. But the cherem was actually used in a very interesting way, at least as reported in the Talmud. And we will get a sense of where exactly speech, what kind of exalted position speech has within Judaism when we see how it was used. So how many of you have heard of the famous oven of Achnai story in the Talmud? It's one of the chestnuts that everybody pulls out, right, when giving speeches about Judaism. Well, hopefully no one, because I'm going to recite it again. But it is one of those kind of jurisprudential cornerstones in the Talmud that in many ways explains the mentality of the rabbis and the system in a fable-like form. And it is as follows. The rabbis were arguing over the cleanliness of an oven. And the sages said, it's clean. And Rabbi Eliezer ben Hyrcanus said, no, the oven is not clean. And by that he meant pure or impure for the purposes of being able to, right, use it for cooking. Right? And they just were debating and debating and debating, and eventually Rabbi Hyrcanus said, well, if you don't believe me, right, let a variety of miracles happen. and a variety of miracles happened, and they still didn't believe him. And then he said, okay, well, let a heavenly voice come down and say I'm right. And a heavenly voice came down and said, yes, yes, you're right. Right? And they still said, too bad, we don't listen to heavenly voices here on earth. We determine what the law is, and you follow the majority. We took a vote, we're the majority, we win. And Eliezer ben Hyrcanus persisted, and they banned him. Now, he's part of the canon, he's revered in the Talmud, but he was also excommunicated. But why was he excommunicated? Not for registering dissents. He was excommunicated because he instructed people to follow the law that he articulated. So here is where Judaism, right, begins to tip its hand, to show its hand. It has a predilection for behavioral uniformity. Behavioral uniformity is the glue that keeps the community together. It has equally a deep respect for heterodoxy in the sense of beliefs and opinions. You can have virtually any opinion you want. There are no dogmas, right? Or if there are, they're very few. And Maimonides, who codified it, the few there are, his books were banned for doing so for about 50 years, right? The Jews said, what is this codifying dogma, right? This is, right? We don't do that. So speech has this exalted, privileged place, but practice, right? That's a different matter. Now, what should that remind us of? Now, in many ways, if we think about the logic of it, it's not any different from the modern state. The modern state protects thought, opinions, expressions, but it regulates conduct. And it's not forgiving about one's conduct, right? If you're in violation of the law, you suffer the consequences. So there's a kind of oddity here, and it's a sort of logic that we might think about a little bit, in that the secular enlightenment project is to a large extent about freeing the individual from authority, traditional forms at least, right? And so criticism of religions is viewed as an extremely important feature of the enlightenment. Right? It is part of that project of freeing one from inherited notions of authority. But actually, what the Enlightenment does is it offers other forms of authority in its stead, and that is the state and its institutions. And so some of the clashes that happen is actually competition about which authority, right, actually counts. It's not necessarily, right, a clash between what we ordinarily think of as religion and the state, or religion, right, and the law. Right. So I want now to move to the dynamics of criticism. I'm just going to ask you how much time I have left, just so I can, I'm good? Okay. Let's look about a little bit more at the question of criticism, because we're living in an age in which criticism of religion has taken enormously dramatic, right, and consequential turns. In a brilliant, though very, very depressing book entitled Anti-Judaism, the historian David Nirenberg details the long and incessant and vituperative tradition of criticism of Judaism, Jews, and Jewishness in the West. And his argument, which I espouse, is that in the Western tradition, from early Christianity through modernity, the West essentially worked out its own ideas about life and society, right, through the discourse of anti-Judaism. Most importantly, the West did this even when actual Jews were largely absent from the scene. This conversation continued in times and places where there were no Jews as a result of expulsions and other similar events. So this is, people used ideas about Jews and Judaism to fashion the tools with which they constructed the world. That's a very, very long, long history of criticism. And we know many features of that long history of criticism that maintained itself. Significantly, Jews are too carnal. They are too material. They are too tied to this worldly concerns. This is all part of, right, an elaboration of Pauline messages, the messages of Paul. The letter killeth while the spirit revives. We all know this, right, that this has been one of the great accusations against Judaism, that it is not spiritual, that it is not a religion of love, right, that it is legalistic, Pharisaic, right, hypocritical, but most of all, that it's physical, right, it's carnal. Commandments are behavior, they're done, right, they're not spiritual necessarily. We don't think about a commandment as something that you do in your mind or in your heart. They're done, they're executed, right? Take the controversies over circumcision, right, as one very prime example. Right? Circumcision was the battleground, right, in early Christianity, right, of a kind of deep failure within Judaism not to spiritualize, right, this commandment and to continue to make it a concrete obligation, right, on the body. And maybe the greatest symbolic expression of this dynamic was in the medieval period, which culminated in the burnings of the Talmud. Because when we think about the Talmud, the book, right, the book was actually a symbol of the concrete corporate existence of Jews in the Middle Ages. Jews had lost a national center, an actual physical national center, and the way in which they kept up a national center was through the book, right, though they were dispersed, right, in exile. And the burning of the book, right, was a vivid way to kind of symbolize a destruction of a corporate, actual corporate existence. I think it's important to understand that because there are echoes today in Europe and in the United States now, right, of this criticism, this dynamic, the Judeo-Christian kind of conversation that has been going on for 2,000 years, and that it's still with us. Not only the Shechita and Milah practices, right, not only ritual slaughter and circumcision, but also, and I think we should include it, criticism of Israel. Because Israel has taken the place to some extent of the book, right? It is a national center. It symbolizes a concrete corporate existence of Jews. And as such, it has become implicated, right? And it is a working out. It's a working out of various ideas in the West about nationalism and globalism, but it's working its way through, right, through this very particular figure, Israel. And we have to keep in mind that though there may well be very legitimate criticism of Israel, there's a story to that criticism. It's deeply important. So criticism has been something that, from the outside, we have dealt with. Now, we've been powerless to do anything but for a long time. But how does, and here's really what I want to focus on, what are the possibilities of overcoming that history? I don't necessarily think that what it is absence of criticism or the end of criticism in society, but rather moments of recognition, right, extended by others. And these moments of recognition actually have the capacity to really do enormous work inside the tradition itself. And I want to focus on two contrasting moments that have, in the contemporary period, that have very much shaped Orthodox rabbinic thought, because it's a glimpse of what not just is the dynamic of criticism, but the dynamic of reconciliation and recognition. So one that I have in mind, right, was really on the heels of, it was not on the heels of Vatican II, but actually it was right before Vatican II, right? Within Orthodox Jewish thought, there had been a very strong and important debate about whether or not interfaith dialogue was legitimate. And one of the most deeply moving texts on this topic was written by a very famous 20th century Orthodox Jewish philosopher, Rabbi Soloveitchik, entitled On Confrontation. And in this article, Rabbi Soloveitchik actually cautions against dialogue. Right? He says, working for a common cause, of course, religion should, of course, cooperate and get together, and all traditions should get together to work for a common cause, right, for the betterment of society. But to exchange theological premises, to understand each other from within, no. And there are two ways to understand his work and why he took that stance, which was actually quite puzzling because he was Orthodox, but he was a very liberal, interesting thinker. One of which was his own kind of deep devotion to existentialist philosophy. He had also written a book called The Lonely Man of Faith. And in this book, and in this piece, what he speaks about is actually the loneliness of religion. That religion is a deeply subjective experience in any faith community, in any singular community. It is lonely. It isn't necessarily going to be understood. And that it's important to bear the loneliness. And the second was the external setting of when he wrote, which was a lot of Jews lobbying the Pope for Vatican II, and it looked like it wasn't going to happen. And people were quite disappointed about that. And so part of it was an attempt to steel against relying on the opinion of others by offering instead a picture of religion as something that is lonely, but deeply fulfilling. So that's one moment. A second moment is actually Vatican II and on the heels of it, the United Nations recognition of Israel. That act of recognition was actually responsible for one of the most moving Orthodox attempts to rethink the question of how much social solidarity Jews owed to everyone else in the world. If you know a little bit about Judaism, because of its particularity, it's primarily focused from an ethical point of view on extra kind of familial obligations that members of the religion owe to one another. Special forms of loving kindness and social solidarity on the order of a family relationship within the covenantal community. And what actually has been slighted, despite all the rhetoric, what actually has been slighted in the Jewish legal tradition, right? From an Orthodox point of view, what has done very little work is the idea of creation of humans in the image of God, the idea that there is just one basic moral community. It exists, but it's very competitive with love thy neighbor as thyself, which is intended to mean your fellows. Right? It exists, and very few norms are shaped around that idea. And this was an attempt to fashion, for the first time, a really serious idea of social solidarity and fellowship at the basic human level, and not only, right, among covenantal members. And if you read very closely what stimulated it, it is very clear that it was stimulated by Vatican II and the recognition by the UN of the self-determination rights of Jews. That is, as he put it, right, we have a long history with Christianity, but today that relationship has been eased, right? That is, I think, a very religious impulse. What's that religious impulse? It's gratitude that comes from recognition. It's the play of recognition and then reciprocity. So those moments are actually very, very important. Now, I want to tie this all together by trying to think through how do we go forward. I've offered you a tradition that has been primarily the subject of criticism, while at the same time believing that free speech criticism is extremely important. Right? Where, from within this tradition, could we get some resources for now thinking through how to handle, right, a new set of circumstances involving the disparagement of religion, right, as competing against the liberal commitment to a world of critical engagement, criticism, right, and a working through of liberalism and Western thought through the medium of criticism. How do we do that? So I actually don't want to put on my legal hat too much here, but I want to say that we might think about legislation in a few different ways. First of all, we can talk about this later because I'm sure I'm running out of time now, and I'm sure that we will talk about it. One of the ways that liberals have begun to talk about trying to restrain speech has been to protect the feelings of religious people. I actually reject that as a valid legal argument, and we can talk about why later. I think that has taken on a very problematic role in moral and political discourse. But liberal arguments about rights, about equality, about fairness, they're still very, very much on the table. And I think equality is really key. And when we think about equality, we should think about it also in terms of moments of recognition. That is, and that need not be done on anything except a very much state-by-state level. Every state has its own particular history with groups. The United States has a very long history with groups, right? Religion, unlike in Europe, was not its issue, but race always was, and in a deep and terrible way. Right? Every country has a different historical experience. Every country ought to shape laws around what is needed in their country based on their historical experience in order to actually make sure that there is equality. And if we can get some sort of sense from the Jewish tradition, it is that acts of recognition are actually, they are the way in which we create equality. And they're owed by the more powerful to the more vulnerable. That is a very strong teaching in the Jewish tradition. Finally, I want to also put on the table one other example that we might elicit from the Jewish tradition, which is that it's not only about law, it's also about ethics. Many, many formulations of how one should speak are commandments that don't have any consequences to them. They're ethical ideas. They're ethical ideals. They're not law in the hard sense. But indeed, in the 18th and 19th century, Jewish thinkers fashioned out of ethics a whole set of rules to govern speech, right? To try to create something called purity of tongue. And what was going on? It was an attempt to create an ethics, to shape character, to shape virtue. Now, we don't think about the state often as responsible for shaping virtue. But we might begin to talk about that, and I think that's what we will do. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Stone, for showing us the diverse approaches of critique in Jewish thought and for showing how appraisal of critique was also seen as an appraisal of God and as, in effect, a decent way of ordering society as a way to think about what keeps a society intact. I think a lot of the points you've mentioned will surely resonate with us for the rest of the evening, and I can't actually wait for the discussion a bit later. So let us continue this conversation with Professor Mondal. Professor Anshuman Mondal is professor of modern literature, specializing in post-colonial studies. He joined the school in September 2016. I should have mentioned the school. It's the It doesn't say, sorry. Professor Mondal, can you just help me? University of East Anglia. So he joined the University of East Anglia in 2016, having previously held academic posts at the University of Leicester and Brunel University, London, where he was professor of English and postcolonial studies. He's the author of Nationalism and Postcolonial Identity, Culture and Ideology in India and Egypt, and Amitav Ghosh and Young British Muslim Voices, an account of his journey across the UK talking to young Muslims. His latest book is Islam and Controversy, The Politics of Free Speech After Rushdie, and he has published essays on Indian literature in English, Gandhi, gender politics and Indian nationalism, modern Arabic narrative genres, modern Islam and fundamentalism, and the politics of the Middle East, contemporary representations of Muslims, and on freedom of speech and freedom of religion, which makes me very happy to have someone to look at these aspects from this basically very interdisciplinary approaches that are much needed. In 2004, Professor Anshuman led an international project on faith and secularism, sponsored by Counterpoint, the cultural relations think tank of the British Council, and wrote the introduction to the pamphlet Faith and Secularism, part of the Birthday Counterpoint series, which was published by the British Council to mark its 70th anniversary. He has also published journalism in the leading current affairs magazine, Prospect, and also The Guardian's Comment is Free section. He has his own blog called Human Zoo, and I advise you to check on his blog, Anshuman Mondal WordPress, after this event. And he has made appearances on several TV shows and radio shows, so he's deeply engaged within all these discussions we are having tonight. He's also chair of the Postcolonial Studies Association, held several fellowships, Melbourne and Wollongong, Australia, and we're very happy to have him here. Please welcome Professor Mondal with me. The floor is yours, Professor Mondal.
Thank you very much, and it's a pleasure to be here this evening. It's my first time in Berlin, and I have been greeted with some wonderful spring weather, which I'm not accustomed to because I live in the east coast of England, and the weather there is still wintry. Thank you very much to the Jewish Museum, and the and in particular to Hafsa and Sophia for their communications with me. And inviting me to this this wonderful event and to discuss the ways in which human rights can be seen through different prisms and perspectives rather than as simply abstract instruments. And I approach this lecture today not as an expert of Islamic law or Islamic history, but as someone who has over the last decade or so wrestled really quite fundamentally with the conflicts between these two fundamental human rights at the center of our discussion tonight, between freedom of speech and freedom of religion. And hopefully you'll see some overlaps with Professor Stone's lecture, and hopefully we'll be able to discuss and explore those overlaps in due course. Not so very long ago, the prevailing view within the social and human sciences was that religion was destined to be eclipsed by secularization. This has not turned out to be the case, which is why the problem raised, at least implicitly, by the title of our lecture this evening, the problem of what can and should be the proper relationship between freedom of religion and freedom of speech, has assumed such critical importance. That the relationship between these two human rights is problematic is increasingly evident. And although it is unwise to pinpoint an exact date, I would suggest that the controversy over Salman Rushdie's the novel The Satanic Verses back in 1988-89 is probably a good reference point for assessing the emergence of the current predicament that we are in. In the several decades prior to this, controversies over free speech involving religion were few and far between in the Western liberal democracies. but have become increasingly prevalent, not to say repetitious, since. In the non-Western world, on the other hand, freedom of religion questions were very prominent throughout the 20th century. The extent to which religion could be accommodated within the framework of the modern states established by European colonial empires and of the nation states as envisaged by the various anti-colonial nationalisms that emerged to contest them was vigorously debated. And of course, since 1989, the ways in which religion, identity, and freedom have become enmeshed in tortuous political coils in the formerly colonized and non-Western world needs no further rehearsing here. The religiously motivated free speech controversies that have emerged in both the Western liberal democracies and non-Western states, both democratic and authoritarian, can be gathered, I think, around the two related but distinct concepts of blasphemy and offensiveness. Generally speaking, in the Western liberal democracies, they have been largely articulated using the idiom of religious offence. Elsewhere, blasphemy remains the preeminent register, although it is interesting to note that in their response to the Danish cartoon crisis, the World Union of Muslim Scholars used a term, ishaha, which refers to insult, harm, and offense, rather than the usual term used for blasphemy, and which is usually used in secular rather than religious contexts. So again, there might have been a shift also in that respect. Now, this divergence between using offensiveness as one idiom in the West and blasphemy as the main idiom outside the West is largely explained, I think, by the fact that the idiom of religious offensiveness is mainly a secularized version of the pre-secular concept of blasphemy, one that is more appropriate for the secularized liberal democracies of the advanced capitalist sectors of the world. Put simply, blasphemy in such a context has lost its force and political purchase, whereas it has not in those parts of the world where secularism has not taken root so firmly. Now, accusations, prosecutions, and trials concerning blasphemy have mushroomed, have exploded in Muslim-majority states in recent years. Pakistan is the usually sort of, at least in the British media, probably because of the colonial relationship, is the usual frame of reference for that. But all over the Muslim majority countries, trials of blasphemy have exploded in recent years. And I'll return to examine why a little later in my lecture. But for now, I want to provide some background context and establish some conceptual grounds. I want to focus on the concept of blasphemy, its place and function in Islamic religious traditions, and its history, before returning once more to the contemporary predicament facing Western, multi-ethnic, multi-religious societies, and the problem of free speech and religion. So to begin with, a straightforward question. What is blasphemy? Nowadays, it is commonly understood to be nothing more than an attempt to prohibit the expression of ideas, beliefs, and opinions critical of religion and religious authority. Although there is some truth to this, especially with regard to religious authority, it is not the whole picture. Indeed, it's in fact quite a recent view, one that has emerged out of those complex historical processes that have led to the assumption that critique and criticism is secular and that religion is dogmatic and averse to criticism. And this assumption is brought into question when we consider the concept of blasphemy with greater historical depth and critical precision. For modern understandings of blasphemy rest not only on a very particular interpretation of what religion is, but also on a profound transformation in our view of what language is, what it does, and how it functions. This modern understanding of language has emerged alongside modern scientific epistemology. And to broadly characterize it, it takes language to be nothing more than a transparent medium through which to communicate empirical observation and experience of the objective world. This contrasts with alternative understandings of the nature and function of language, which predate modernity, but still have some residual force, even in largely secular societies, and are still predominant in largely non-secular ones. This is the idea that language is not simply expressive, but performative, that it does not simply convey ideas and information, but in fact it is also a form of social action that seeks to effect some change in the material circumstance of the world. This is very different from the idea that language is nothing more than a transparent and neutral vehicle of ideas, opinions, and beliefs. This older idea of language as performative, as endowed with the power to affect the material world, can be dated back to antiquity and was, until recently, one that had universal purchase across cultures. I say until recently because, of course, it has been displaced by this idea that has emerged in the modern period of language as simply expressive, as just a transparent vehicle for communication. The potency of the word was acknowledged by Aristotle in his description, to take a few examples, of the phallic songs of Greece, by the tribes of pre- and post-Islamic Arabia, by the shamans and priests of Central Asia and Western Africa. All across the world, people have, for millennia, been harnessing the magical potency of words to cast spells, to curse, to swear oaths, to invoke the gods through prayer and ritual, to abuse and insult political opponents. All of these uses of language speak to its performativity insofar as they all seek to achieve a desired effect in the world. Thus, when we define blasphemy as the abuse and insult of God and religion, we are not simply talking about the expression of ideas, opinions, and beliefs, but also about a form of social and political action that seeks to use the potency of language to injure, which is why injury is such a key aspect of the notion of blasphemy. Historically speaking, the injury caused by blasphemy was not seen as purely metaphorical or ideological, as modern sensibilities assume, but physical and material as well. It's telling that we find in Leviticus reference to the son of an Israelite woman blaspheming the name of God with a curse, and we've heard some more detail about that. But the verb used here, according to the scholar John Tolan, is the word to, which means to perforate. Blasphemy is the crime of piercing the divine name. Although in early Christianity there is an association between blasphemy and heresy, heresy that is the idea of deviant doctrines, so this link between deviant doctrines and blasphemy, there is also in early Christianity a recognition of the distinction between blasphemy and heresy. The Emperor Justinian, for example, issued the first piece of civil legislation concerning blasphemy within the Christian tradition. His proclamation notes that, and I quote here, "Some men use blasphemies and swear oaths by the deity that incite the wrath of God. Famine and earthquakes and pestilences are caused by such sins, and so such blasphemies are to be prohibited." And I quote again, "lest by disregarding such sinners, the city and the republic may be injured by reason of their impious acts." Here we see clearly two things. First, the swearing of oaths is not simply a form of expression, but a form of action, a speech act. Second, in this passage, there is no relation to heterodoxy, no association of blasphemy with deviant doctrine. Rather, blasphemy is associated with social disorder. And this distinction within the Christian tradition between blasphemy and heresy persists, even as late as Henry III of England's mandate of 1253 AD, which prohibited Jews from, and I quote, disparaging the Christian faith and from disputing with Christians about it. We see in the very distinction between disparagement and disputation the separation of blasphemy from criticism. So there is a less straightforward answer to the question, what is blasphemy? And it is to say that we should focus not on what blasphemy is, but on what it does, and on what its prohibition attempts to do. From this perspective, the history of blasphemy is not so much about the suppression of dissent and the protection of religion from criticism, but rather about the upholding of a particular social order, an issue that Professor Stone has already touched on. There are two related aspects to this. The first is that the proscription of blasphemy is intended to protect a given social and political structure that is underwritten by a divine logic, in which the sacred is its conceptual and ideological centre. The second is that it defines this social structure by policing its boundaries, admitting only those who recognize and acknowledge that center, while excluding those who do not. Insult and injury are the key tropes in the concept of blasphemy, precisely because its main concerns are social and political, not theological. Indeed, one might even go a step further and suggest that blasphemy is less about religion than about the composition of society, and less about religious than about political authority. Although, of course, when the two are inextricably intertwined, it is difficult to disentangle the two. And that is exactly the point. Blasphemy only appears to be principally about religion, precisely because in largely secularized societies, that relationship between religion and political authority, between God as the logos of the social, God as the logos of the socio-political order, has been displaced. I say displaced rather than dissolved, because one interesting line of thought that emerges here is that in secularized societies, the crime of blasphemy has itself been secularized. The logos is now not God, but the nation or the state. And the crime of blasphemy is now not treason against God, as the title of Leonard Levy's famous History of Blasphemy tellingly puts it, but treason against the state. It is expressed now not through the abuse and insult of God and religion, but through the crime of sedition, which is cognate to the idea of seduction, which is itself, as Talal Asad reminds us, a close analogy to the Islamic notion of blasphemy. Indeed, a closer examination of blasphemy in Islamic history illustrates and corroborates this alternative reading of blasphemy that I'm pursuing here. In Islamic discourse, blasphemy is denoted by two terms, and I apologize for my Arabic pronunciation, Saab, meaning assault, abuse or insult, and shatam, meaning to abuse and vilification. There is no reference to Saab in the Quran, and only a single verse, Surah 6, verse 108, that uses the term shatam. Interestingly, this is actually a verse that seems to imply civility is a necessary correlate of religious toleration. And I quote the verse here, "Abuse not those idols to whom they pray, or they will abuse God in revenge." The connection to blasphemy here is an indirect one. it assumes both believers and unbelievers have a mutual and vested interest in avoiding blasphemy, and presumably thereby avoiding social conflict. Avoiding blasphemy, then, is the assumed ground of social discourse for unbelievers and Muslims alike. By about the second century of Islam, there is evidence that blasphemy against the Prophet had become intolerable. All the hadith collections, hadith are the collections of sayings attributed to the Prophet, contain stories and traditions that condemn vilification of the Prophet and later also his companions. In the early development of the Sharia, we see that there are legal penalties for unbelief and apostasy, but not for blasphemy against the Prophet and the companions. That is, until about the end of the 3rd century and the beginning of the 4th century of Islam, or the 9th and 10th centuries of the Common Era. That is, nearly 300 years after the death of the Prophet. The German scholar Lutz Weiderhold summarizes thus: blasphemy against the Prophet Muhammad and his companions is an issue that was introduced into the chapters on apostasy and unbelief of the legal manuals only after the formative texts of the legal schools had been compiled. There are a couple of interesting things to note about blasphemy in Islam. First, blasphemy is conceptualized in relation to abuse and vilification of the Prophet and later his companions, but not Allah. It appears that Allah is perfectly capable of looking after himself. Second, it appears that, historically speaking, the concern with blasphemy emerges out of a prior concern, and more fundamental concern, it seems, with apostasy and unbelief. Now, nowadays, questions of blasphemy are seen to be inextricably intertwined with apostasy and unbelief, and thereby seemingly corroborating the idea that blasphemy is about suppressing religious dissent and criticism. But in early Islam, apostasy and unbelief are themselves approached not primarily in terms of ideas and opinions, that is, as deviant discourses, but in terms of what we might nowadays call identity. The background to these crimes, to the development of these crimes within the schools of Islamic jurisprudence, was overwhelmingly political. The Shia Sunni conflict on the one hand, which was principally a political rather than a theological conflict. On the other hand, there was the problem of political governance as the Islamic polity expanded rapidly from a tribe of tribes amongst the Arabs to a multi-religious, multi-ethnic empire. It's no surprise then that blasphemy in Islam focuses not on God, but figures of political as well as spiritual authority. And it's no coincidence either that blasphemy emerges in relation to these political crises, for these crises drew into question the basis of political authority and whether Islam is an Arab religion or a universal one. Questions of political authority, social order, and who is and who is not a part of the community are all embroiled in its emergence. Seen from that perspective, the prior and more fundamental concern with apostasy and unbelief is less about what apostates and unbelievers actually believe or the opinions they profess, and more about what they represent as threats to the Muslim social order in terms of challenging its political establishment, or as figures that dissolve the boundary between the Muslim community and its others and non-Muslims. To put it briefly, there is in this alternative history of blasphemy in Islam a strong correlation between political crisis and periods when questions of blasphemy become prominent. In Islam, the very concept of blasphemy only emerged during such crises, and it is the same now. The endemic and systemic political crises that have engulfed the Muslim majority countries since the 19th century have coincided with another period in which blasphemy has become prominent. And this is why blasphemy is used in these countries largely to attack political dissidents and religious and ethnic minorities. Let's now return to the problem at hand, the proper relationship between freedom of religion and freedom of expression. I have argued that blasphemy does not in fact have anything to do with religion or theology, that it uses religion simply as an idiom through which the vocabulary of power is expressed. If blasphemy laws are therefore not designed to protect religion as such, then it follows that they are not an appropriate response to this problem, because they do not fundamentally address questions of religious liberty. Indeed, they restrict the religious liberty not only of minorities, but also of religious majorities by binding theological questions to political authority. Moreover, if the purpose of blasphemy is to enforce a single religiously mandated social structure, then this cannot obtain any longer in radically pluralized multicultural societies. But as we have seen, the concept of blasphemy has lost its force in such societies anyway, and has been replaced by the idiom of religious offensiveness. So, in order to give greater protection to religious liberty, should we therefore protect religious believers from speech acts that offend them? Professor Stone raised this very tangentially at the end when she talked about this debate about protecting feelings, religious feelings. There are many insuperable problems with this from both logical and juridical points of view. First, there is the subjectivism of offence. Offensiveness is in the eye of the offended. Since not everyone who hears a particular utterance will be offended by that utterance, we can say that offensiveness can never be an inherent property of certain kinds of speech. Second, we can therefore never be sure which categories of speech act should therefore be prescribed. Potentially, all speech acts could theoretically cause offence and be prescribed. Because third, and this to my mind is the most important reason, the subjective character of offence means that it is open to potentially limitless political manipulation. The question that arises next is, should we protect religious believers at all? There are at least two responses to this, one of which is very straightforward. The very existence of freedom of religion as a human right suggests that we should protect religious believers. To ask whether we should protect religious believers at all is really to ask whether there should, in fact, be a fundamental right to freedom of religion. But if there should not be such a right, then we firstly assume that the protection that is afforded to religious believers can be adequately performed by the human right to freedom of conscience and freedom of speech. Then we need to ask whether freedom of conscience and freedom of speech can, as human rights, adequately protect religious liberty, not just in terms of beliefs, but also religious practices. I don't believe they can. They can guarantee them the right to hold religious beliefs. They can guarantee them the right to utter and articulate religious speech. But that doesn't mean that they enjoy freedom of religion in its widest sense, because they do not guarantee that they can worship and live according to their beliefs. Conscience and speech may be protected, but religious performance, ritual duties, and so on would not be. We should also protect religious believers based on the principle of equality. If we do not protect religious believers, then in order not to treat religious believers unequally to other categories of persons, we are effectively saying that no one should be protected. There should be no limits to free speech. There are many reasons, and I don't have time to go into all of them here, why such an absolutist position is untenable. And this is recognized by the qualified nature of the right to freedom of expression. It is known in human rights jurisprudence as one of the qualified rights, not one of the fundamental and inalienable rights. There are and should be limits to free speech, both legally and morally speaking. The question is what those limits should be, what they are, and here we are concerned with those limits in relation specifically to religion and religious identity. If blasphemy laws are not viable or desirable, and neither are attempts to protect religious believers from offence and to protect their feelings, then on what ground might we limit free speech with respect to religion and religious identity? I would suggest that the protection of religious believers can only be grounded on the principle of regulating hate speech. Addressing John Stuart Mill's famous argument in his book On Liberty, that the only basis for restricting liberty is the very simple principle that only harm to others justifies such restrictions, many have argued that hate speech does indeed cause both psychological and physical harm. The case, I think, has been put most forcefully and cogently by the legal and moral philosopher Jeremy Waldron in his book, The Harm in Hate Speech. Arguing that human rights are grounded in what he calls the dignity of persons, Waldron writes, and it's worth quoting at some length, "Dignity in the sense in which I am using it is not just a philosophical conception of immeasurable worth. It is a matter of status, one's status as a member of society in good standing. And it generates demands for recognition and for treatment that accords with that status. Philosophically, we may say that dignity is inherent in the human person, and so it is. But as a social and legal status, it has to be established, upheld, maintained, and vindicated by society and the law. The dignity of the human person is therefore grounded in an equality that is ontological and social and juridical. However, hate speech is always tied to inequality. It promotes the lesser moral worth and dignity of other persons and is an offence to what the philosopher Ronald Dworkin calls the equal concern and respect that is, for him, the basis of liberty itself. It is also, I would suggest, the basis of free speech. If the purpose of free speech is reconceptualized as the promotion of mutual understanding as opposed to simply free expression. It follows, therefore, that if this purpose is to be both enabled and to any extent achieved, then hate speech must be limited. And while certain forms of hate speech might be limited by law, others must be confronted and challenged ethically, made inarticulable by moral pressure within civil society. The politics of free speech in this respect represents or involves the attempt to rule out some forms of speech on the basis of what a society believes to be morally unacceptable because it clashes with its fundamental values. This, I think, is the appropriate arena for challenging offensiveness rather than the law. The most promising avenues for juridical regulation are, to my mind, incitement to religious hatred and group defamation. But won't such legislation stifle criticism of religious ideas and beliefs, and thereby restrict religious dissent? There are many reasons why I believe this will not be the case. Some, especially those concerning defamation, or the precise definition of what constitutes incitement, are very complex, and I won't go into them here, perhaps in the discussion later. But there are two broad reasons I will mention here. Firstly, many countries, including Germany, which has some of the strongest provisions in this regard, do have legislative regulations with respect to either incitement to religious hatred or group defamation, or both. And their public cultures have not noticeably been flattened into religious conformism. Secondly, we need to return to this idea of language and speech act theory. Language is not simply a transparent medium that simply conveys ideas and opinions. It is performative. It is a form of social action. It does work in the world. It has consequences and effects. It follows that language can be used in different ways for different purposes. Some forms of utterance do indeed contribute decisively and usefully to public debate. Others do not. Some use language for the purposes of critiquing and contesting ideas and beliefs. Others do not. Others use it to insult, denigrate, abuse, and vilify people, and thereby bring their dignity into question. Yet others still use language as a form of violent assault. It is therefore possible and desirable, I believe, to regulate hate speech acts carefully, and I'm not promising this is going to be easy. In fact, it's going to be very difficult. But anything worthwhile is always difficult. It is therefore, I believe, possible to regulate hate speech acts carefully and forensically so as not to stifle debate and dissent. There cannot be any easy answers here, nor can there be any hard and fast fixed rules. That is the challenge that we face when it comes to this kind of arena of thought. To conclude, in response to Mill's very simple harm principle, I would like to finish with a fairly simple principle of my own. Criticize religious believers for what they think, what they believe, what they say, how they behave amongst themselves and others, what they do to others. But never abuse, insult, vilify, or verbally assault anyone simply for being who they are. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Mondal, for connecting the power-related dots between critique, blasphemy, harm, and equality. And I'm sure we will come back to many of these points in the course of the discussion. Now, allow me to pose questions to each of you before I open the floor to the audience to pose their questions or remarks. So, Professor Stone, it seems that today there is less controversy in Judaism around blasphemy or religious taboos. This means that there is more leeway in tolerating differences, or these differences are less, or these controversies are less scandalized. My expression is that taboos and limits of tolerance today lie actually elsewhere, namely in how to view not so much the differences in the religious traditions of Judaism, but the views on the Jewish nation or the Jewish state, and that this has become the litmus test for Jews vis-a-vis other Jews and Jews vis-a-vis non-Jewish communities. Do you see a shift in what communities consider sayable, as Foucault would say it, or critiquable, or maybe differently put with the words of Professor Mondal, do you see that God now has been replaced by the nation state? So to critique the nation state is to the modern way of critiquing God. Do you see these shifts?
Okay, I think there are many questions that are involved in that question. I don't think that, I want to start backwards, which is this question of whether God has been replaced by the nation state. And there is something to that I want to talk about, and not just from a secular point of view, but rather also from a inner Jewish conversation. Because what we also see in the 20th century, and it is part and parcel of certain aspects of what we might call religious Zionism, what we see is something very unusual that has happened, and that is, for the first time, people are understood to be the Messiah, the community, right? So Judaism has always had a kind of vision of history in which the Messiah right, will eventually appear and redeem. That is a classic Jewish notion. And of course, that's part of the long history of Jewish Christian critique, because Jews never believed that the Messiah came. That's the central, one central argument. With the rise of Zionism, within certain religious groups, there came to be a philosophy that began to associate the actions of individuals in settling the land and in creating the state with the idea of redemption. Right? And that is really the first time that redemption came to be seen as something that is in the community. And it did a lot of different things, so that the community was understood to be not just religious adherents, it was also understood to be secular Jews. It was a kind of virtual community, because secular Jews weren't thinking about the Messiah. Right? So it was a kind of one-sided virtual community. But in that way, I think that Zionism has created a tremendous amount of theological shifts that are quite interesting. And it's also created very particular internal arguments about what is the meaning of nationalism in the Jewish context. Right? So even from a religious point of view, what splits religious adherents about what is nationalism within the Jewish context is whether nationalism means peoplehood, right? That there is a kind of two overlapping communities, a kind of theological community and a national community, an historic community, that Judaism consists of both. And one of the disagreements, so for example, among those that really have rejected Zionism as having any kind of religious value, is the notion that what created the community in the first place, what actually created a nation known as Jews in a particular religious imagination, is the acceptance of the commandments. The analogy will be difficult, but in a way, it's a little bit like saying what created, from the perspective of an American, that what created a nation in America is the Constitution. And adherence to the Constitution and understanding oneself as we the people of the Constitution, right? That's our national identity. It's not some sort of pre-existing peoplehood before that. Right? That's actually kind of structural in American thought. And that is the line of thinking among many religious adherents who have rejected the value of the State of Israel as a religious value. That doesn't mean they reject it as a value. They reject it as a religious value, right? They don't give it religious significance. And it's not given religious significance because in the end of the day, religious nationalism for this group, right, is not about settling the land. It is about keeping the commandments. And we shouldn't substitute one nationalism for another nationalism.
Thank you. Professor Mondal, thank you so much for showing us how understandings of blasphemy changed over the course of time, and especially that it is, in fact, periods of crisis that blasphemy has been used by religious communities to attack dissident voices and religious and ethnic minorities. Now, my question is, how do Muslims today, how could they make use of this rich tradition of pluralism and tolerance that does exist in Islam to expand the limits of what is sayable, while at the same time they are or perceive themselves to be in a constant attack by Western discourse, Western violence, as much as inner Muslim violence, or simply provocatively put, will there be no Muslim tolerance as long as Muslims and their identity are under attack?
Yeah, I think it's very difficult to engage in that form of self-criticism and the excavation of those buried histories when there is a wider context in which the idea of Muslim itself, because we talked earlier about the figure of the Jew in Nirenberg's anti-Judaism, but then there is, you know, in current context, the figure of the Muslim, which stands proxy for a whole series of associated connotative ideas to do with violence, fanaticism, and so on and so forth. I think the opportunity to engage in that level of self-criticism is made more difficult, let's put it that way, within that context, which isn't to say that it cannot and shouldn't be done. And it is being done. That is one of the frustrations, I think, that many Muslim communities, especially in the Western liberal democracies, have with the way in which their image is portrayed to non-Muslims, which is that a lot of this internal criticism and debate, which is still current and is still going on, and is still happening despite the bullying tactics of some of the more intolerant and fanatical sections of Muslim communities, is not being projected or picked up on and reflected in representations in the media. In your introduction to myself, you mentioned the book that I wrote 10 years ago based on a journey across the UK, meeting young Muslims, not activists, not political thinkers, not any, just young Muslims who I had managed to persuade to talk to me, who had all sorts of normal jobs, some of them weren't particularly religious, others were. Some, I won't mention the names or anything, but who probably believed, had more faith in their local football team than they did in the Quran or anything like that. Very different kinds of Muslims. And those conversations are happening. But you'd be very, very hard to find any of that in the representations in the media. So it's not just about having those conversations, not just about doing the really hard educational task of pulling all of these rich histories out. After all, you know, it took me several weeks of digging around in specialist university libraries to find out some of this stuff. For people who do not have access to those resources, for very poor immigrant communities who have very, very little access to education per se, that task is even more difficult. So, yeah, the task needs to be done. It has to be done. You can't use the excuse that we're a community under attack to put it off. But that doesn't mean that you cannot also acknowledge the fact that context in which Islam is represented in the Western media is also not a factor in how Muslims respond to that.
Thank you. I assume that there are a couple of questions in the audience, and we have time for a few questions. So please raise your hand if you want to pose a question to any of the speakers. Questions? Okay, anyhow, you would need to put on the headphones, sure. Because some of the speakers might want to post. You're free to, Sie können gerne auch Ihre Frage auf Deutsch stellen. Und wir haben Kolleginnen, die das dann übersetzen. Deswegen sollte Sprache jedenfalls nicht das Problem sein. So feel free to ask either in German or in English, or just whether it's questions of clarifications or any remarks or comments you want to make to any of the speakers. There's one here. Sure.
Ich habe mir immer die Frage, warum habe ich immer den Eindruck, wenn ich mit einem Muslim spreche, dass der sich permanent so fühlt, als wenn er immer angegriffen wird, und so reagiert er auch.
Also ich habe das Problem, dass wenn ich mit einem islamischen Menschen spreche, dass er meist sich so angegriffen fühlt und so auch zu mir reagiert, dass also selten ein gutes Wort kommt.
Die Frage ist für Professor Mondal, nehme ich an, oder?
Ja.
Professor Mondal.
I think this is what I was saying about the general context in which it is difficult to develop self-criticism within a context in which one is constantly being attacked from outside within the media. it is a very difficult situation for that person or those people to respond to that positively. In a situation where that is constantly happening all the time, and it's not just Muslims in this current context, many, many minorities in different contexts have experienced the same situation in which, because they are in a wider context being put under suspicion or represented in such a way as to they feel is unfair to them as persons or reduces their dignity as people, to be able to respond positively to criticism from outside makes it even harder. It's just one of those political scenarios that really I think is one of the reasons why the establishment of and I think you said called it the purity of tongue, which isn't to say don't criticize or don't do, but to establish an atmosphere in which it is clearly recognized and acknowledged by everybody that we are all trying to attain some form of mutual understanding that is really so vital and urgent. We'd really need to try and create that scenario. In a scenario of conflict and hostility, that's not so easy. It's not so easy to respond positively. So I guess that is one of the reasons underlying one of my arguments, which is in what way can we relate freedom of speech to this problem of creating an atmosphere or a moral climate in which the goal is to enable and to facilitate, to help people to engage in that constructive criticism of each other rather than the perpetuation of a conflictual atmosphere in which people cannot rise to the challenge of doing that. It is very difficult. Just as human beings, it's very difficult. If my wife is constantly criticizing me, it's very hard for me to undertake that self-criticism and say, oh, yes, you know, you're absolutely right. That bit of my behavior is not so good. Most people respond very defensively and negatively to that if the criticism is constant and hostile.
Is there anything you would want to add to Professor Stone? I mean, the question wasn't addressed to you, but if you feel like it resonates with you, or either the question or the answer.
It's an interesting thing. I come at this, I think, from a somewhat more classically liberal viewpoint. And I do worry about an overregulation. How do I want to raise my children? Well, I know how I want to raise my children. I want to raise my children so that they speak with utter respect to anybody who they come across, no matter who they are, right? With utter respect. But do I feel that some of the creative urges of the Enlightenment would be lost by overemphasizing notions of respect? Yes, I do. And it worries me. It really worries me, because the edge of criticism is a working through of one's own, right? It's a working through in modernity of, I think in some ways Nirenberg has a point. It is a working through of what liberalism at some level means, right? What it means to be free. And so I worry about this a little bit.
I think you're absolutely right. I mean, I don't come from my philosophical grounding is not in a liberal position. And that's part of my work, is to try and see how can liberal precepts and concepts, human rights, how can they be made to fit with non-liberal approaches as well. And my initial starting point is, are there approaches to freedom of speech that are not liberal? And I think there are. but I think you have to completely go back to basics. Yes. To change the entire premise of what this is why I wanted to talk about language, to change our understanding of what language is. You know, very, very sort of fundamental philosophical recombination of precepts to get back to that position.
Yeah, I think this is so complicated because I'll say something that is a criticism from within my own tradition, which is purity of language, right? There's a tremendous code of purity of language that has been developed within Orthodox religious thought. But there's a price for it. And that price is enormous conformity and a certain loss of the personal. Gossip is a terrible thing, but gossip is also social glue. Right? It is the way in which we become intimate. It's how we know one another, right? It establishes a bond immediately. And when you are within a community in which gossip is not allowed, there's a flatness, and you can sense it and you can feel it. So I do want to put on the table the complexity of it. And I think we have to think about that.
Yeah, I totally agree, and this is not going to be easy. Like I said at the beginning of my last comment, I'm not trying to displace or overcome liberal ideas. I'm trying to see how they might be able to fit with non-liberal assumptions. Like I said at the end of my lecture, I'm interested in regulating a very, very narrow set of speech acts. Actually, I come from this not from a religious perspective. I come from this as an anti-racist activist. And the work that we did in the UK a generation prior to my own, that culminated in the 1986 Public Order Act and the incitement to racial hatred legislation. That work took 2 or 3 decades of political preparation for it to become possible to think about the idea that incitement to racial hatred is something that a society should feel like regulating. And actually, you know, I don't think the result of it has been a flattening out. In some ways, the re-emergence of racism in the UK, especially now post the Brexit vote and so on, is possibly an indication that it didn't actually do its job, and that it's not robust enough. And we might have to look at that. But my point is that, again, the political pressure, the work in civil society to try and say, look, try and see this from our point of view. If, as minorities, we're constantly, at the basic level, our humanity is constantly being called into question, how can we be taken seriously in this marketplace of ideas? You know, our voices will not have the same worth and value and weight as those who are deemed to be superior to us. Okay, so that in American critical legal studies, as you know, that's called the subordination argument, in which the fact that a group is subordinated it basically involves their own freedom of speech being made unequal to others, because when they say something, it's not taken seriously. So that is where I come from the anti-racist activism, actually. And I have a very simple question about the point of anti-racist activism. What is the point of it? Okay? Is it to say that we're anti-racists, but then tolerate racist speech? Or is it to ethically campaign in civil society to literally make racist speech unthinkable? I think that is what I'm campaigning for. I'm not campaigning to tolerate racism. I'm campaigning to make racism unthinkable. That is the premise that I start with. If you make it unthinkable, you make it unspeakable. Your freedom of speech is necessarily going to be closed in that respect. Yeah? So we can't think of it simply as let's have everything open and nothing closed. some things have to be closed if you value that. If you value equality of races or equality of religions or whatever, you have to close some things off. It's the choice. That's the difficult choice that you have to make. So there will be a price, no doubt about it. I'm not apologizing for the price. That's the difference. I'm saying that you have to make that choice. What do you value? What do you value in your society? And then you proceed from that.
We have time for one last question. Sorry. I wish, over there, please go ahead. One last brief question.
Ja, vielen Dank zuerst. Also ich bin Muslime und ich bin seit Jahrzehnten in diesem Land. Und ich habe jetzt die Situation wirklich sehr schlimm vor uns. Als ich hier kam als Student, habe ich hier studiert, man hat uns nicht wahrgenommen. Gut, wir waren damals nicht sichtbar, wahrscheinlich. Aber im Laufe der Zeit, wir sind sichtbar, auch die Situation in der Welt hat sich geändert. Meine Beobachtung, meine Erfahrung, also ich bin jetzt nicht zu Hause geblieben, ich habe versucht, mich einzumischen in alle verschiedenen Ebenen, also ob das Studentenverbund oder auch in Gewerkschaft oder auch bei der Arbeit. Und wir haben auch eine Vision, also als Muslim haben wir auch eine Vision. Eigentlich, wir haben die Erfahrung, dass es diese Multikultur bei uns oder Multireligion von unserer Kultur. Wir haben Christen, wir haben Juden, wir haben alle möglichen Glauben, aber auch Ethnien. Und wir haben, ich sage vielleicht in Anführungsstrichen, wir haben gut gelebt, bis vor dem Kolonialismus. Oder ich sage immer, wir waren auch in Spanien, es waren Christen und Juden, haben auch gut gelebt, zusammen fast 800 Jahre. Diese Geschichte wird ausgeblendet bei Europa. Ist keine, also ich denke, das ist eine Bildungslücke in dieser Hinsicht. Ich versuche auch jetzt zur Zeit bei den Schulen, also wo meine Kinder ist, mich zu bewegen und sagen, es gibt Gemeinsamkeit zwischen uns. Abgesehen von allen Unterschieden, lass uns über Gemeinsamkeit reden, dann können wir uns annähern. Und zuallererst muss man die Geschichte, jetzt höre ich die Klassen, die politische Klasse sagt, Islam gehört nicht zu Deutschland. Aber wenn, der, wenn er nur die Sprache, die deutsche Sprache mal nachforscht, die arabischen Wörter in der deutschen Sprache, ist eine Menge. Auch die Wissenschaft, auch diese, diese moderne Welt jetzt zu verdanken ist den Muslimen. Sie haben die Griechische übersetzt, weitergegeben und hat auch entwickelt und hat sie weiter. Das ist eine Bildungslücke. Meiner Meinung nach, die Bildung muss sich inhaltlich ändern. Da kommt die nächste Generation, vielleicht können wir uns besser verstehen. Aber trotzdem, das ist jetzt meine Vision.
Okay, war das ein Kommentar, den Sie...
Das war ein Kommentar.
Jemand vom Panel...
Er kann vielleicht das erweitern oder...
Genau. Ja. Professor Mondal, do you want to comment
well,
on the comment?
It's a comment, so it's not really a question. Yes, of course, education in history is vitally important. You know, we talk about all sorts of groups in society and so on, and Islamist groups and so on. Everybody rewrites their history all the time. That's how history works, through a process of perpetual revision. The task is to contest histories that promote conflict and so on. It doesn't mean that conflict didn't happen, even during these periods of convivencia and all of these things. Of course there were conflicts. It wasn't some sort of great big utopian past. But that is not the same thing as saying there aren't resources, repositories of hope in that past that we can draw on now. Because if they did it, if they had some answers then, imperfect answers, but answers still, maybe we can draw on them now. And I think one of the things that a lot of the extreme fanatical Muslims that participate in politics these days, as well as the extreme right wing and racist groups and so on and so forth, is maybe you should try and have a look at some of those other facts I know it's a term of abuse and derision these days because of President Trump, but there are alternative facts around, you know? There are alternative histories that need to be thought about. Yeah, there's no excuse for ignorance anywhere, but it does mean taking some time to think about your past and think about how complicated we all are. Yes, you know, the Arabs were absolutely influential in translating Greek thought and Hellenic thought, Romanic thought, into the Renaissance. But you can't just leave it at that. You've got to think about how can that spirit of open inquiry and intellectual endeavor be resuscitated, resurrected now. That's a starting point, it's not an end.
Thanks so much, Professor Stone and Professor Mondal, for coming, flying over and sharing your work and insights with us. And before we can thank you with a big round of applause, please let me announce to you the next event we're going to have here at the Academy on with the topic, the title, Equal Before God and Equal Before Humans, with Professor Suzanne Herschel and Katayun Amipour on May 3rd at 7 p.m., And now, please join me in giving a big round of applause for Professor Stone and Professor Mondal.